I'm Jason Clay with the Iowa Waste Reduction Center here at the University of Northern Iowa. And with me, we have our two student employees, Michaela Gasper from Wentworth Institute of Technology and Eliana Hornbuckle from Brown University. Today, we're going to demonstrate the do-it-yourself bin system. So first thing you want is a bin like this. And what we're going to do is drill holes in the bottom so any excess moisture has a way to escape the bin. My assistant. So we're just going to drill four holes, one on each corner.
And how big should the holes be?
They should be about a quarter of an inch or an eighth of an inch. You just don't want them too big so that the worms can readily crawl out and they're constantly having to put them back into the bin. So now that that's done, we're going to prepare our bedding. So you can use a variety of materials for your bedding for your worms. Here we have coco coir, which is made from coconuts. You can also use leaf material, straw. We're also going to use shredded paper. And it's always a good idea to include finished worm compost or traditional compost in there just to inoculate your system with microbes. One of the important things with worm composting is moisture. We're going for 60 to 80% moisture, which differs from traditional compost. You can have it a little bit wetter. The worms do need moisture to be able to move through the bedding material and breathe through their skin. The test for worm compost bedding is similar to traditional compost in terms of moisture. You do a squeeze test. So we're going to do a squeeze test here with our coco coir. You can test it and see if you think it's moist enough. 60% will give us a couple drops coming out of the hand. And it looks like that's pretty good.
Nice.
And you never want to add dry material to your worm bed. You always want to moisten it before you put it into your bed. So what we're going to do is we're going to mix this up, and then we're going to put it into our container. In the worm container, you want approximately 4 to 6 inches of bedding material to start off with. That's good to go. Okay. And then we can start putting in here. And we have more behind us that we can add if we need more. So we're going for about 4 to 6 inches, so about right there.
Okay. A large clump of paper.
And then we'll also add some of the finished worm compost or worm castings to help inoculate the new bed. So again, we're using coco coir, but you can use sawdust, leaf material, yard waste as part of your bedding, shredded paper. Okay, now that we have our worm bin filled, whenever you feed your worms, you want to add an inch of food scraps to the top. And you don't want to add additional material until the worms have actually consumed that 1 inch of material. Otherwise, it can become anaerobic. So what we're going to do now is add an inch layer of food scraps to this bin. So once you have about an inch of food scraps on your worm bin, you want to add an additional layer to help keep moisture in. And I usually use newspaper that's been moistened before I add it to the bin. So the moistened newspaper just helps to keep the moisture in the worm bin so it doesn't dry out as quickly. And you don't ever want to water your bin like you might do with traditional compost if it's dried out. You want to actually use a spray bottle to lightly mist the surface area. And you just want to make sure that the materials are always moist. You don't want to let them dry out, but you also don't want it so wet that you have water seeping out the bottom. We did put holes in the bottom, but if you're doing the moisture content right, you shouldn't have to worry about stuff coming out. So that's it, your worm bed's ready, and all you need to do is add worms. So this is an active worm bin, and it's a tray system. And the great thing about worms is they generally self-regulate their populations. So their population will only get large enough to fill the container that they're in. They won't outgrow it generally. But the great thing is you can actually take from your active bin and create new bins. So we have our new bin that we created earlier. This is an active bin, so we're gonna take worms from here, add it to our pile, and then add it to our new bin so we can start a new bin of worms. So the first thing you do is we're gonna pull the paper back and we're just gonna grab handfuls of material from here, put it on the table, and we'll grab worms from the active worm bin compost and add it to our little pile there. And the worms they don't like light, they're light sensitive. So typically if you have light shining on them, they'll generally burrow into the pile. And then once you're done, you'll have a nice compact pile of worms that you can add to your new worm bin. And it's fine if you add material from here too. You don't have to be too diligent about separating the worms because it will actually inoculate the new worm bin with the microbes that are in the active bin. It will have the same effect as when we added compost to our new worm bin. Red wigglers are the preferred composting worm because they tolerate the widest range of environmental conditions. They are cold-blooded, breathe through their skin, and small bristles along their bodies help them move easily through loose organic matter on the soil surfaces where they live. As they do so, they consume microbes and small bits of organic material.
I'm imagining like a red carpet runway.
So now that we have our worms separated from our existing active bin, we're going to add them to our new bin. So all we need to do is scoop up our pile of compost and worms and add it to the top of our food scraps that we have in the new bin. For a worm bin, generally the wide range of temperature is 55 to 90 degrees. The optimal temperature is 72 degrees. Since we're not going for thermophilic composting, we're not going to have a compost pile that heats up. So you can assume that your ambient temperature and your worm bin temperature are going to be closely aligned. But if you want a more precise reading of your worm bin temperatures, you can purchase a little thermometer like this that is specially made for a worm bin. Add it to your worm bin, and it'll give you a more accurate reading of the temperatures in your worm composting system. So with our do-it-yourself bins, one of the easiest and uncomplicated ways to separate the finished vermicast from if there's any unprocessed materials is to do what we did earlier when we were separating the worms out of the vermicompost. Another way you can do it is by sifting it. And in this example, we're using one of my trays from the multi-tray system as a sifter. It has about 1/4-inch squares in it. You can also build your own. Build a wood frame, as long as you use 1/4-inch hardware cloth or 1/8-inch hardware cloth, either will work. You'll just get a finer or more coarse material at the end. So once you're sifting, what you'll end up with is a nice, fine vermicast that you can apply to your community gardens, your garden at home, your house plants, nutrient rich, that the worms and the microbes helped you to produce.